we're beginning a brand new series today. So as we begin, let me ask you a question. How many of you, as kids, you loved adventure? How many people, you loved to go out where it was unpredictable, mysterious, follow, you didn't know what the outcome was going to be. It was thrilling, it was fulfilling, it was exciting. But why is it often that as the older we get, we can become more staid? We attempt to control the outcomes, we want certainty in those things. Our air of, we want life to be safe and secure and predictable. But the problem is, when life becomes predictable, it's boring. And life was meant to be an adventure. And here's the problem. Too many Christians are bored with their faith. And our enemy uses that in two ways. One is that it causes some to stray from their faith. And otherwise, it also causes people who should be attracted to Jesus, see the lifestyle of his followers, and say, I don't want any part of that because it's boring. And it's an easy trap to fall into, because what happens is you can become so intent about not wanting to do anything that's wrong. And it's not that we want to do it, but your focus can become not wanting to do wrong that you forget about what you're called to do is right. You forget about the adventure that God has called us all to follow. We can become like a young man that the Bible says he was wealthy. He came to Jesus and he asked him about how he could live the life he had always longed to live. The Bible called him a rich young ruler. When he came to Jesus, Jesus found out that his focus was upon the commandments, what he shouldn't do. He said, I had never done any of these, but although that's commendable, Jesus offered him to follow him. He offered him of an adventure. And because his focus was so much about what he shouldn't do, he wasn't ready to step out in faith. You see, and it's impossible to live by faith and to be bored simultaneously. See, our preoccupation with safety and security and protection, we pray for protection. I pray for protection, right? But sometimes when we pray for protection, when's the last time, let me ask a question, when's the last time you've ever asked God, when you've ever prayed and said, God, make me dangerous? Dangerous to the enemy's plans. Here's a wild thought for you. Do angels ever get bored? Do they ever yawn? I mean, have we opted for so much safety and security that we give them nothing to do? You see, you and I were born for adventure. We were born to follow after God. We were born to pursue the plans and purposes that God has for our lives. And you and I must see that what happens often when we want things predictable, then where does trust come in? Where do we learn? See, our faith grows when we learn to trust, because the life that all of us dream of living is right before us. And Jesus promised that he would send us someone to guide us into all the affairs of life. He promised the Holy Spirit would come into our lives to lead us and direct us. And therefore, you and I need to realize, when you remove the Holy Spirit out of the equation of your life, it spells boring. But when you add him into your life, anything can happen. And you and I, if we are not living an adventurous life spiritually, if our spiritual life isn't adventurous, then we're settling for something far short of what God's intent and plan is for our lives. It's something that I call inverted Christianity. Instead of following the Holy Spirit, we invite the Holy Spirit to follow us. And therefore, instead of serving the purposes of God, we want God to serve our purposes. We have our plans. We have our ideas about life. And we say, God, bless this. God, do this. And we figure it all out. And God's saying, hey, what about following me? What about the things that I have for you? Because following the Holy Spirit will lead us in places we never imagined going, down paths we didn't even know existed. We were born for adventure. We were born to follow the Holy Spirit. In fact, if you're taking notes with me this morning, look at this. Following the Holy Spirit is the life you were born to live. Following the Holy Spirit is the life that you and I were born to live. This series that we're going to be doing over the next 5 weeks, I'm calling Wild Goose Chase. Wild Goose Chase. Why? Because it's about rediscovering a life of pursuing the Holy Spirit. It's that understanding, because I know that name might sound to some a little sacrilegious, but Celtic Christians had a name for the Holy Spirit. It was the On God Gloss, translated, it's the wild goose. The wild goose. Why? Because like a wild goose, the Holy Spirit cannot be tracked or tamed. There is a hint of mystery and intrigue. When you follow Him, you're not always sure where He's leading and what direction He's going. And so there's a sense of unpredictability to it. And whenever we experience circumstantial uncertainty, we must remember it can go by another name: adventure. And God has invited us to follow the One. I believe Celtic Christians were onto something. To know that to follow the Holy Spirit was truly a wild goose chase, because the adventure of faith is found in the chase. The adventure of faith is found in the chase. See, to us in the English language, a wild goose chase is an idiom for a fruitless endeavor, a pointless pursuit, something that seems like that it's futile to do. But whenever we follow the Holy Spirit, it is far different. Because where the wild goose leads us, we may not know, but we can rest assured of this: God is working His plan. God is figuring out. God has a plan for each and every one of our lives. And this is something that we need to settle, that He's God and we're not. Following Him means we learn to trust Him. The more we learn to follow His leading, our faith grows. Our capacity to know that He has our best interest at heart. It's learning to pursue the Holy Spirit, to allow Him to guide our lives, that we experience the most exciting adventure. And that's something that we have, because pursuing God passionately can be unnerving. It can be disorienting. And the earlier that we deal with that spiritual reality, the more we can enjoy the journey. And so therefore, chasing the wild goose isn't about safety, isn't about certainty, but it is about an adventure that will absolutely never be boring. So in the course of this series, today's the introduction, we're going to look at wild goose chasers, both present day and some from the Bible, to come alive to us. Because here's my desire for all of us, is that through their lives, you would be inspired to step out in a way you've never stepped out before, to allow, to give God the opportunity to lead your life in ways you've never been willing to go before, to experience the life that God has for you, the one you've always dreamed about living, that you will never, ever experience until you have the courage to chase the wild goose. So if you have your Bible this morning, turn to the book of Romans, the book of Romans, chapter 8. If you're new to Bible reading, just find the New Testament, sixth book of the New Testament, the book of Romans. The Bible is not a book. The Bible is a collection of ancient manuscripts. And here, Romans is a letter that was written by the Apostle Paul to Christians that were living in the city of Rome. They weren't real creative in what they named a book back then, but his. It was called the book of Romans because these Christians were living in the city of Rome. Paul was giving them instructions. And you come to Romans chapter 8 and look with me. If you don't have a Bible, you can turn. The notes are in your bulletin. These notes are designed to help you to not only gain information from this, you're not limited to my thoughts, write your own down, but my hope is that you would take it home, get it into your heart, so that there's a courage and an excitement in you to step out and allow God to lead your life. So listen, Romans chapter 8, we're going to start in verse 14. Look what it says. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. See, we were born for this. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. Look at verse 15. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, But you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry, Abba, Father. Verse 16. For the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Verse 17. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, we may also be glorified together. Now here's something I want you to see from the scriptures. Is that there's two words that are used here. And I love this because although we in English might use these terms interchangeably, in the Greek language they were very exact. And in verse 17 of Romans 8, it says that we are children of God. The word children is the Greek word technon. I put this in your notes. And it simply means a child. Technon is a child, and it refers to birth. Being born into a home, you become a child of those parents, okay? But then there's another word. In Romans 8:14, it says, and these, those speaking of those who are led by the Holy Spirit, these are the sons of God. The word sons is the word weos, okay? Now, the difference between weos and technon, weos refers to a relationship. Now, Kathy and I have two boys, okay? And when they were born as babies, our relationship was limited. They had limited understanding and capacity. They had limited ability to interact with us. You know, goo goo gaga, and it was nice that we wanted them to smile. But there's very limited interaction you can have. But as they grow, and here, think about this for a moment, okay? We use it this way in English. We understand this, that as children grow, we expect more of them, correct? Anybody out there a parent? As your child, when they're an infant or when they're a toddler, you expect certain things of them, but you don't expect much. But as it is now, our oldest son is 16 years old. We expect far more of him today than we did when he was 1 or 2 years old, correct? Well, in the Greek language, it bears this understanding, just as it is in English, we recognize that as children grow, their relationship with the parents grows, and as they mature, they can handle more responsibility. Now, go back to Romans 8:14, and look at what it says here. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons. The word sons deals with the essence of maturity. A relationship whereby the Father has come to entrust in them. You take just by context alone, when you talk about an inheritance. If a young child tragically lost both of their parents, then we know we would normally not give that inheritance to that child directly. There would be a guardian that would be put over it. And at a certain age, at a certain point, then they would come into the fullness of what was left for them. Well, it bears the same understanding that we, as we mature, as we grow as children of God, God unfolds to us more of what we've inherited through Christ. And so this is critical. Look at me. Look with me far here. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, these speaking of who? These are talking about those who have learned to be led by the Spirit of God. These are the sons. So maturity from God's point of view has to do with you and I being willing to grow in our responsibility to respond and obey the leading of the Holy Spirit. As we learn to follow Him, we grow and mature in our faith, and God can entrust more and more to us. But I love this, as many. It's an open invitation to every single one of us. And with God, there is no discrimination. No discrimination in race, no discrimination in sex, no discrimination in age. In fact, watch this video with me of a goose chaser right here in our church.
Bonnie struggled with self-doubt, depression. In her life, she had two husbands, and the first husband she had a child with. The child never knew his real father, which I can connect to because I don't know my real father. So this summer, I went on a mission trip to Belize with the youth. When we had gotten to the airport, we found out that our plane had been delayed. While we were at the airport, we just gathered around and started worshiping. And while worshiping, a crowd of people started surrounding us and just listened to what we were doing. And there was this one lady who was just crying and crying. And I felt a voice in me telling me to go pray for her. She needs you. In my mind and in me, I was saying, I can't do that. I'm not good enough. I started worshiping again. During the song, How He Loves, that presence came over me again, but louder and stronger, and told me, go pray for these people. And I realized that it was God telling me to go do this. I got up the courage and I went up and prayed for this woman. And while praying with her, she had called her sister on the phone. She asked if I could pray for her as well. As I was talking to her sister, I led her to Christ. That was something I hadn't really done before in my life. There was another woman sitting there. She was crying, and I knew she was struggling with something. And I felt that presence come over me again and tell me, you have to go pray for her. So I went over and talked to her. I found out her name was Bonnie. And while praying for her, I was just declaring such great things and holy things in her life. I didn't even know this woman. And I was saying things like about her child, about her husband, about her family. Mind you, I'd never met her in my life. She was a complete stranger. So while praying for Bonnie, she shared her life story with me. She asked me for advice on her life. I'm only 15. What could I share as advice to her? But God gave her the advice that she needed through me. After praying for her, I realized that voice inside of me, the Holy Spirit, could work through anybody, and that He chose me and God used me and showed me that no matter how hard or how weird or unnatural it is to go pray for somebody or help somebody, that He knows what is right, and that when you're listening to the word of the Holy Spirit, they should take it and go forth with it. And not just hold it back and say, I can't do that. I'm not good enough. No, God obviously chose you because He wants you to connect with somebody because He knows that you are good enough.
See, Austin, he's only 15 years old. One of the kids that went on our mission trip here this summer at Vertical Church. He's 15, so what excuse do you have not to obey and follow the Holy Spirit of God? See, God wants to take you on that adventure, and you and I could do it. And here, again, Romans 8:14, as many, it's an offer. But maturity comes as our responsibility to learn to hear and respond to the leading, the prompting, the direction, the guidance of the Holy Spirit from within us. And it's that way with God. Think about it. We don't use it differently as regular human beings. We recognize this, that as young people grow and mature, we give them more responsibility. Don't we allow them to drive not only after they turn 16 years of old, but don't they have to pass a test? Don't they have to know certain things? You have to be 18 years of old to serve in the military, and then you also have to be accepted into the military. See, we understand this, even as human beings, that as there's a growth, that as there's a maturing process point, that it's those who are responsible that you give more and more ability to be able to do. And so it is maturity from God is all about our ability to respond to the Spirit of God. If you're taking notes with me this morning, listen. Faith is grown by obedience shown. Faith is grown by obedience shown. The Bible says without faith, it's impossible to please God. But you see, faith is that ability to trust God. That I don't know everything. I don't understand where you're leading me, but I trust that you have my best interest at heart. I trust you know the end from the beginning. You're God, I'm not, and I'm willing to follow you. That's how our faith grows. And faith is grown by obedience shown. The more we respond, the quicker we are to sense the leading of the Spirit of God and respond to it, the more God can trust us. The more God can rely on us. The more God can work through our lives to to accomplish his will on earth. Let's talk about how this works. Go over with me to John chapter 3 and look at this for a moment. John chapter 3 and verse 6, Jesus said these words. He said, flesh gives birth to flesh, right? How do children come into the earth? Well, a man and a woman, in the act of marriage, a husband and a wife bring children into the earth, right? Flesh gives birth to flesh, but listen, but spirit gives birth to spirit. To be a child of God requires a spiritual birth. You and I must recognize that when we place our trust and faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone, that God does a miracle inside of us. We are what the Bible calls born again, spiritually regenerated. If any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. And it is important to understand that our born again spirit is now sensitive or in tune with the Holy Spirit because he's born of the Spirit. So look at verse 7. Jesus said, you should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. See, to become a child of God, that's where people have a misnomer. Not everybody who's born on the earth is a child of God. The Bible says to as many as receive him, to those he gives the right, the privilege, and the power to become children of God. Children of God are those who have accepted the work of Christ on the cross to bring about spiritual regeneration, the ability to have a relationship with God because we are changed from the inside out. And it's that born-again human spirit that is in tune with the Holy Spirit. So how does the Spirit work? Look at verse 8. This is so awesome. Follow me. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. Now follow me for a moment. The thing about wind is you can't control it. You can't determine when it comes and where it goes. All you can choose to do is cooperate with it. And the more apt you become cooperating with the wind, we realize is wind provides so many opportunities. It can generate power. It can move things. You see its effect. Although you don't see it with your physical eyes, you feel its effect. You can hear it. And so is everyone who is born of the Spirit. As the summer's coming to an end, my family and I had the chance this week to go out with friends of ours, close friends of ours. And we were out on Long Island Sound in a boat. And the gentleman we were with was a very, very skilled navigator and, you know, sailor and all. And so when people learn and understand sailing, they know how to work with the wind. They know how to read, how it moves, how to set their sail. Because anybody who's a sailor realizes catching a wind the right way can be very beneficial. It provides you the opportunity for transportation and all sorts of things. But if you catch it the wrong way, it can bring destruction to your ship. And you and I must recognize, like a wild goose, the Holy Spirit cannot be traced or tamed. All you can do is follow him. And he is like the wind. I love this. The wind blows wherever it pleases. It's an analogy for the Holy Spirit. So you could also say it wherever he pleases. In other words, it's not us telling the Holy Spirit how we want him to operate. Our responsibility as growing as Christians is to sense where he's leading, to understand his impressions and the way he works in our hearts, to sense that and work with that, cooperate. Because our born-again human spirit, let me give you an analogy. Our born-again human spirit is like a sail. And we're designed to be able to catch the wind of the Spirit and move with him, to go in the direction that he leads us. But so often, like a sailor, our sail is down. We're not even in the game. We're not even prepared to do anything. See, you can come into a place like this on a Sunday morning, and you can say, man, I'm ready. God's here. And the Spirit of God can be moving. And yet, we sit and watch everything go by. Because why? Our spirit isn't even open. Because we're worshiping and we sense this draw inside of us. Let go. Be free. Lift your hands. Don't worry about everybody else. But we intellectualize it. We start thinking about it. We say, oh, well, what do people think about me? And whenever we begin to do that, we don't do anything. Or the Spirit of God comes and he begins to move. We have this draw, this tug. We feel like, man, I need to go over there and encourage that person. And then we have every reason, every excuse in the world why we talk ourselves out of it. The Spirit of God is moving in our lives. See, he'll move upon us to be generous. We have 1,000 excuses not to go there. We have palms where he'll move in us to be compassionate, to reach out and to be kind to somebody. But we think, no, that's for somebody. Oh, I got to. We have our plans. We have our agenda. We have our plans. But yet, do we catch the wind? Because maturity is our ability to sense it. Because here, God taught the prophet Elijah. He brought him up on a mountain one time. And on that mountain, the Bible says there was a great wind, but the Lord was not in the wind. There was a great fire, and the Lord wasn't in the fire. There was a great earthquake, and the Lord wasn't in, but in the still, small voice. The gentle tug. See, the Holy Spirit's been moving on some of you today to be kind to somebody else. You know you need to forgive someone, and you have 1,000 reasons why you don't do it. You have other things. It's saying, hey, you need to reach out. You need to go first and say, I'm sorry. You need to humble yourself. And you go, no, ain't no way. You know what they did, and we have every right. The Spirit of God moves in our heart. But here's the thing that we need to be sensitive to. The Bible tells us today, if you hear His voice, don't harden your heart. Because we can become insensitive to the leading and direction of the Holy Spirit. See, it's our ability to catch it, because good sailors can read the wind. They know how to do it. When you think there's no way that's going to go, they can catch a wind and go somewhere that way. And God wants that as we mature and grow, that we have that level of sensitivity, because sometimes the leading of God is not intuitive. You know, we were doing a baptismal service this week, and the text I used was out of Acts chapter 8, when God led the Philip the evangelist down into the way of Gaza, into the desert. He was having this great revival. And then he's led down there, and then the Spirit of the Lord says to him, go overtake that chariot. And when you read the story, the chariot was the chariot of a person of great authority in the Ethiopian kingdom, okay? So you figure there's got to be bodyguards and security around, you know, a couple tripped out Escalades, guys with, you know, wires coming out of their ears. But he doesn't tell him what to do. He doesn't even tell him what to say. He just says, go overtake the chariot. And so often the impression of the Holy Spirit will come inside of us, and we sit there and analyze it. We sit and think about it. And you see, God has divine setups the whole time. I remember this one minister that I listened to for years, and he told this story. And it's so true, because we want to understand it all before we're going to step out and do it. And God said, whoa, 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 whoa. Do you trust me? Faith grows when you learn to trust His leading, because you don't know all the end. If you know everything in advance, then it isn't faith. It isn't a trust in God. It's relying on your ability to intellectualize and understand it all. But can you be as a child and say, okay, I'll go where you say go. I'll do what you say go. See, God wants to work with us, but can He trust us on that front? And this minister told the story that he was in a meeting. He actually had this guy come to his church who had given him a hard time. But he was trying to act in love, and he wanted this man. He came and was ministering in his church, and the Lord moved on his heart and said, give him a week of your salary. And that was a lot of money. And this guy was already struggling, learning to trust God with his financial affairs. And he had 1,000, he fought with the Lord through the whole service. And finally, he relented and says, you know what, I'll do it. And he gave that man a week of his salary, okay? 2 weeks later, he's somewhere else, and the Lord moves in his heart again to be generous and to give. He's like, what's... But he does it, okay? Now, he has no idea that God is working in him for a divine plan. But listen, and multiple folding, God always is that way. 2 months later, he's called to go minister to a, in the denomination he was with, this friend of his and his wife had severe cancer. In fact, it had gotten to the place where she was beyond all medical help, and they sent her home to die. She was in the final stages of that end, and he was asked to come to the house and pray. And so they went into this minister's home. She was lying in the bed. He and his wife went in with the other minister, and they were standing there around the bed, knelt down to pray, and the Lord spoke to him and said, get up, go to the foot of the bed, and told him what to say and what to do. And immediately when he did that, the Lord performed a miracle. And this woman rose up off of the bed, totally and perfectly healed. Now, see, we want God. Use me that way. But the Lord said to him a week later when he was praying about it, see, if you hadn't obeyed me by giving that man a week's income, and if you hadn't obeyed me and being generous in the time that I took, I could not have used you in that situation. See, we determine, it says, the wind blows where it pleases, not what you design, not what you want, but can you obey what the Spirit of the Lord is leading you to do? Even when you don't understand it, because it can be unsettling. It can be like in your mind, seemingly a wild goose chase that I don't get it. I don't understand it. I don't know, because God knows the end from the beginning. Can you trust? It's like this, I don't know if you've ever heard of Kenneth Copeland, but Kenneth Copeland, I heard, told a story years ago, and he said this. He had been led by God to go to attend Oral Roberts University, but he struggled with it for 5 years because he was like 30 years old. How am I going to support my family? I'm married. I have 2 young kids. How do I stop working and go to school? And for 5 years, he fought with God and didn't do it. And finally, because life had not gone the direction he had to surrender and obey God, and he went to ORU. Okay? And he was learning to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. And one day, he's walking across campus and he hears, he catches the wind of the Spirit. And the voice tells him, go to the top floor of that building in front of you. So he goes, it's a 5-story building, and he goes all the way up to the 4th floor. And it's an empty classroom, it's a science classroom. He's like, well, God, he's so discouraged. I'm like, why, God? Why did you send me here? This is dumb, this is stupid. And as he was thinking about it, all of a sudden, inside of him, the impression came, no, I said, go to the top floor. Now, you have to understand, on the top floor were the executive offices. Not the school administration offices. It was where Oral Roberts, office was and other people on his team. Okay, he had the Oral Roberts evangelistic organization as well as the presidency of Oral Roberts University. And it was forbidden for students to go unless you were invited. You were not allowed to go to the top floor. They could take disciplinary action by going up there uninvited. And all of a sudden he was frozen. He said, okay. He ran up to the front. He goes, ran in. And was like, oh my God, what do I do now? So he goes to the lady who's the secretary that's there and says, my name is Kenneth Copeland, and I just want you to know that I'm a commercial pilot. I've been graded on multiple fronts. And if the school ever needs a pilot, if they never need that, I just felt that. I want to come up here and tell you that. I'm offering my services free of charge. Just saying whatever came to him. And at that moment, Oral Roberts walks out of his office and said, excuse me, son, what's your name again? He said, Kenneth Copeland. He said, did I hear correctly that you're a commercial pilot? That you've been graded to fly jets and all that? Yes, sir, that is. He goes, well, I was praying a week ago, and the Lord told me, because I needed a brand new pilot to pilot my crusades, to take me to all the different things we were going. And the Lord said, I'm sending the man I want you to hire, and he will come to you today. So I've been waiting in this office for the man to show up and say that he was a pilot that came. Now, only God can set up those types of things. See, we figure, oh, if I go all the way up there, I'm going to get a job. Okay, God, maybe I'll go up. No, 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 no. Can you catch the wind? Can you flow? Can you go? Because listen, this is where we struggle. If you're taking notes with me, listen. Mental analysis causes spiritual paralysis. We try to overly intellectualize this. But can I be real with you today? God won't fit in the confines of your cerebral cortex. God is not limited to the left brain of your logical thought processes. God is bigger than what you can imagine or dream. And mental analysis often causes us to cause the spiritual paralysis. Whenever we sense the leading, we try to figure out, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? I don't know. And then what? It passes us by. We don't actually obey. We sit around and analyze and think about it and think about it and think about it and think about it. And the opportunity goes right by us. God wants us to mature and grow. Trust me, I'm bigger than your brain. Can you put your faith in me? Because mental analysis creates spiritual paralysis. So let me go to this last scripture with you. Go in John chapter 16 and verse 13, which is fascinating at this particular point in Jesus' ministry. He's about to go to the cross. This dialogue happens from John 14 through 16, it's Jesus' final dialogue with his disciples. And what I would bear to say, it's the most important things he needed them to know, because he knows he's about to leave. And what's overwhelming is when you go through and you read this, that Jesus' number one topic, his most important thing to get across to his followers, to the guys that he's going to entrust his ministry to, is for them to know the ministry of the Holy Spirit and be ready. Be ready to follow him. Be ready to allow him, because what I'm asking you to do, you're not capable of doing by yourself. But I'm going to send you the one that will empower you. I'm going to send you the one that will give you success. I'm going to send you the one that will guide you and lead you in the way that you need to go. Therefore, listen carefully to me right now. I'm telling you about this. And look at what he says. In John 16:13, Jesus said, "But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth." Now, let me stop there for a moment and help you, because this might help some people. Whenever the Holy Spirit leads us, he will always lead us in perfect unity with the Word of God. He will never lead us outside of what God's already revealed to us in the Bible. See, one of the ways that we can have a safeguard against deception is that the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth, and he will always guide us in the truth. Jesus said, "Thy word, O God, is truth." Now, being in ministry, this is an occupational hazard I have. People will come up to me and tell me their leadings at times. And, you know, years ago, somebody came up and told me, they said, "Listen, the Lord spoke to me." And you know, when I throw that down, that's the trump card. It's like, what am I going to say? It's like, okay, I'm going to argue with God. And the Lord spoke to me that I'm to leave my wife and marry this other person. And my thought is, I said to him, "Well, I'm not sure which Lord you're talking about, but we're not talking about the one from heaven. We're not talking about the one that sits on the throne that made the heavens and the earth." Because see, the Bible said what God has joined together, let no one put asunder. So the Holy Spirit isn't going to lead you to do something stupid and crazy and put God's name on it. That's one of the reasons that unbelievers have trouble with we, the followers of Christ, because we claim some of the stupidest stuff. We put it off on God. Okay? No, he is the Spirit of truth. Sorry, that's just a side note, but I think it'll help some of you. He will guide us into all truth. In other words, why did God go through the painstaking cost of having his word written? When you look at the collection of ancient manuscripts and the ability for the Bible to be given to us as a collection that we can hold this day, that cost God immensely. But it was important to us. Why? Because do you know the problem with deception? You know what the problem with deception is? Let me tell you. The problem with deception is it's deceiving. Now, that may sound simple, but see, the problem is when somebody's deceived, they don't know it. Because if they knew it, they wouldn't be deceived. God's word is a light to our path and a lamp to our feet. The entrance of his word gives light and gives, I love this part, gives understanding even to the simple. So God has mercy on simple-minded people like myself, that the word of God makes it plain and clear. That's why when people argue with the Bible, it's like nothing left to say. The Holy Spirit will always lead us in unity to that. But look at the next thing he said. And he will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is to come. Now, look, second reality out of the scripture, listen. The Holy Spirit will speak to you. Question is, do you believe it? See, Jesus said he would. And the fact is, he has been talking to us more than we actually acknowledge. See, the same Holy Spirit that told you to apologize to your wife this morning is the same Spirit that you've been ignoring in so many other ways. The Holy Spirit is there with us. The Holy Spirit is in us. The Holy Spirit will speak to us. The question is, are you listening? See, we have a way. We want God to do this. We have all of our plans settled. And listen, the wind blows where he wills, not where you will. He will move in us. And Jesus said he will speak to us. We need to build the capacity to believe that what Jesus said is true. Because if this is a lie, you can burn the whole the rest of it. But Jesus is telling the truth. The question is, will you believe the truth? Because he said he will speak to you. And notice this last piece, which is so cool. And he will tell you what is to come. Think about that. The Holy Spirit, because he's God, you talk about having an advantage. You talk about having an adventure. He will tell you. He knows the end from the beginning. He knows what's coming. And if we will learn to grow, if we will learn to mature, if we will learn to believe and trust, he will show us things to come. God gives the upper hand to his kids. He gives us the ability to succeed in life. When others are all around us as sinking sand, we know where to stand because God will lead us in the way that we are to go. He will guide us in the affairs of life. The question is, are we listening? You ever gone through a guided tour before? See, if you've never been somewhere before, I did that when my youngest son, when he turned 10, he and I went to New York City for a few days just to hang out, you know, father-son bonding time. And one of the things we did, we got the city pass and went a bunch of places. And we went up the Empire State Building. Now, I'd been up the Empire State Building a number of times, but I never had gone through, the pass that we bought had this tour that you could put on the earphones and listen. It was fascinating. I learned things I never knew. It was so cool. I didn't know that they built that thing in 14 months. Amazing, okay? What can happen without government regulation, but we won't go there. Listen, sorry. Okay, bottom line, and guess what? It's been standing strong for a long time, so sorry with the commentary. Listen, the guidance of the Holy Spirit, he's our guide. He knows the spiritual things of our lives in better capacity, in better ways than we can even begin to understand. Jesus told us he'll guide us. So listen, this is, if you're taking notes, listen. It's the Spirit's guiding that makes life exciting. It's the Spirit's guiding that makes your life exciting. When you're willing to follow him, boredom and that sense of predictability goes out of the way. And God begins to open up to you the understanding that life was far more exciting than you ever even dreamed or imagined. Chasing the wild goose, as I said before, is not about predictability. It's not about safety. It's not about certainty. It's about the adventure that God has for you. So how do you do so? Let's end today with these four simple things, because how do you apply what I'm talking about? Simple. Number one, if you're taking notes, how does this apply to you and I? Number one, we can pray. We can pray. Well, that sounds overly simplistic, but listen to me. It's when have you gotten up every day of your life and gone in time with God and say, God, I'm available today. Holy Spirit, use my life today. I'm not calling the shots. I'm looking for you. Whatever you say, do, that I will do. Whatever you say, that I will say. I'm available today. Like the prophet Isaiah in the throne room of God said, here am I, send me. When you get up, see, something happens. When you begin to pray, it builds a communication and an understanding between you and God, but more importantly for you, it builds a consciousness. Not only of believing that he is with you, but a willingness to entrust to God your opportunity to say, I'm available, I'm ready, I am today preparing because I trust that you will direct me and lead me. So it begins with prayer. Starting that union to you, say, God, I'm available today. Holy Spirit, lead me, direct me, guide me. Number two, okay? Number two is this, expect. Expect. In other words, hopefully you don't pray things and don't expect what you pray to come to pass. Yeah, there's a lot of people who do that. I've watched it, okay? People will pray for something and then they'll talk the total opposite. Did you believe anybody was on the other line listening? Do you believe God is actually... See, praying with the understanding that I truly believe that this is possible, then I should go about my day expecting. In other words, I got my antenna up. It's on my radar. I'm looking for the opportunities. God, where are you moving? What door's going to open? I'm going to walk through. Wherever I sense the wind, I'm going to move. I'm going to respond. I'm going to do. I'm expecting you to use my life today. I'm not calling the shots, you are. I'm ready, I expect it. God, just say it and I'll do it. Just lead me and I'll go. See, the question is this. See, the wind is blowing. The question is, are you going? See, you need to ask your neighbor, when the wind is blowing, are you going? Yeah, ask the neighbor next to you. When the wind is blowing, are you going? Now you can look at the other person that you ignored on the other side of you and ask him the same question. So you got to expect that God's going to move in this capacity in your life. So we pray, we expect. Number three, we yield. See, it's leaning into the wind. It's setting up your sail. See, the problem is so often we've got the sail, but we don't even have it furrowed. We got it all bound up. It's all there. The Spirit may be blowing, but we ain't got no capacity to catch it because we ain't expecting and we ain't ready to yield. But the Bible tells us, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to what? Your own understanding. It is when you try to figure God out that you won't do anything. You won't go anywhere. You will live the most dull, boring, and absolutely lifeless life. But God wants so much more for you. The life you've dreamed of living is right before you, and you have a guide, but you got to lean into it. You got to yield. That means when you feel it, you got to step out of the boat. You got to go somewhere. You got to do something. You got to open your mouth. You got to be like Austin in that video. You got to say, you know what? I'm not going to let the excuses talk me out of thinking I'm not worthy. I'm going to go over and pray for that woman. I'm going to go. I'm going to follow. I'm going to yield and do it. Do something. Yield to him. Give in and allow him to move your life, because just like wind, when you catch it, it'll move you. And fourthly, which is important, learn. Learn. And this is important. Why? Because you're not going to hit it right every time. You're probably going to miss it more often than you catch it in the beginning. But let me ask you a question, because the Bible teaches us walk in the Spirit. Anybody here a parent? I'm a child when they were learning to walk. When a toddler reaches that point, I don't know, 14 months, whatever, when they start hanging on, they all of a sudden start to walk, right? You ever see a kid just instantly walk across the room? No, what happens when they first start? They fall. Now imagine this. See, kids, when they're learning to walk, fall all the time. It's constant. If they gave up... I tried that. I tried to follow the Holy Spirit. It didn't work. I've had it. I'm going to crawl for the rest of my life. I'm not walking. No, you're going to miss it. And that's where you need to have the humility to learn, because you learn as much through your mistakes as you learn by your successes. Because why? Because when we're honest, when we have evaluation, we go back through it, we can realize that our own will, our own desires, and our own things can cloud our judgment. When we're really honest about it, I had a selfish motivation that really wasn't the Holy Spirit. That was me just wanting something. And putting God's, signing God's name to it. But that's a check that bounced. And you can learn from those fronts as much as you can learn from your successes. So it's a learning experience. It's like you have to have the tenacity of a kid. Get up and go again. Get up and go again. Doesn't matter if you fall. Get up, brush yourself up, and learn to do it again. Because your maturity as a believer is all about your ability to sense the leading of the Holy Spirit and follow him. And the more mature you get is the more you're able to catch the wind and allow him to move you into the affairs of life and to do the things that only God could do in and through your life, to have the most exciting, to have the most spectacular life you ever dreamed of having. The adventure of the faith is found in the chase. It's that. So imagine with me as we close what your life might look like if you actually today walked out of this place and said, you know what? I'm actually going to do something with what he was talking about today. I'm actually going to go home and say, God, I give you, in fact, I'm not even going to wait to go home. I'm going to say today, right where I am, before I leave this place, God, if there's somebody you want me to talk to, if there's somebody you want me to pray for, if there's somebody you want me to give something to, if there's any area you want to use my life, I'm not calling the shots, you are. God, I'm going to step out. I'm going to allow the Spirit of God. I'm going to start to chase the wild goose, whether I understand it or not. I'm not going to think about the unpredictability of this, the unsettledness, the uncertainty, the unnerving side of stepping out. I'm going to learn to trust you. Imagine what your life might look like. Imagine the excitement and the fun and the adventure your life might become if you actually began to live the life you were created by God to live. Imagine what might change. Imagine what God might be able to do in and through your life that he would never be able to do until you're willing to chase the wild goose. Amen. Bow your heads. Let me pray for all of us today. Father in heaven, give us the courage and the boldness today, Lord, to step out, to no longer play it safe. Lord, I think of the disciples that were in the boat and you came walking to them on the water. It was only Peter that had the guts, the courage to step up and say, Lord, if it's you, tell me to come. And actually come when he was beckoned to come. See, it's easy to sit around and sit in the boat where it's safe and secure. But how many opportunities pass us by in life because we're not willing? to trust you. We're not willing to allow our faith to be stretched and to grow. We're not willing to say, yes, God, I don't have to understand all the details. I'm willing to step out. I'm willing to trust you. I'm willing to believe. I'm willing to follow the Holy Spirit. I do believe I was born of the Spirit. I do believe the Spirit of God lives in me, that he's there to talk to me. I do believe, Almighty God, that you have great things in mind for my life. And I'm willing today, give me the courage and boldness to just say, yes, I'm going to follow. I'm going to run the race. I'm going to pursue the chase. Spirit of the living God, I'm coming after you.